Alright, today's notes are titled Circulation. We're going to be learning about the Coriolis effect, overall circulation in the atmosphere, and then, of course, how that affects the ocean in creating those particular surface currents. The first thing that we need to understand about how these molecules of air are moving around is something called the Coriolis effect. The Coriolis effect definition is here on the screen behind me. The tendency for the path of a moving object to deflect to the right in the northern hemisphere and to the left in the southern hemisphere. This particular concept is extraordinarily significant when we're talking about weather and when we're talking about the movement of water molecules. It explains why we have these winds moving in all directions. What we talked about last class period with the globe was the heating of the Earth occurring here right around the equator. This is where the sun's rays are most intense. As the sun's rays shine down with intensity here, the air molecules that are in contact with the surface of the Earth warm up. Those air molecules rise. Well, now there's no air molecules here, so air gets pulled in from the south, from the north, along the surface towards the equator. That air is going to warm up. It's also going to rise. Well, we already have air molecules out here, so these are the molecules that are rising after those first set of air molecules are going to push those molecules somewhere. It's not going to continue to go out. Gravity holds those air molecules close, so some of those air molecules are going to go to the right, or to the north, and some of those air molecules are going to go south. They're going to cool because they're away from their heat source, which is the Earth. They're going to sink and be pulled back towards the equator. They're going to sink and be pulled back towards the equator. But we don't have winds just moving from the poles to the equator, from the poles to the equator. That's not how our winds are moving. The Coriolis effect explains why we have winds that are moving in these different directions in different locations. They're not just moving north-south, they're also moving east to west. And this effect gives this apparent sideways movement to these particular objects moving over the top of the Earth. Now this deflection, this sideways movement, it's best to think of these particular molecules of air as billions of tiny balls that have been thrown up above the surface of the Earth. As they travel, the Earth itself is going to be still rotating underneath them. What you need to make sure that you're aware of is that when we're in the northern hemisphere, these particular objects, these molecules, these billions of tiny balls, always are going to move to the right. In the southern hemisphere, they always move to the left. So taking a look at this picture, you can see that because of the rotation of the Earth here, around the equator, if this is a huge, enormous cannon that fires this cannonball towards the North Pole, what actually happens if we're watching that cannonball fly is that it doesn't go straight. It actually has this curve. And there's reasons that it has this particular curve, because the speed of the Earth here at the equator, because this is the widest part of the Earth, that was an essential skill, back in unit number one, this equator here, objects on the equator here are moving much faster than objects that are up here. If you're at the North Pole, in one day you have to literally turn around like this. But if you're at the equator, you're having to move in one day a much bigger distance all the way around, so you have to go much, much faster. So this object has a lot more speed because it's starting at the equator, and it's deflecting to the right. This is spinning what appears to be much, much slower. So that's our Coriolis effect. The cause is the variation of speed that the Earth's rotation gives to these particular objects that are on it. Now, we've actually done tests to see what is the speed of the Earth at these different locations. So at the equator, going over 1,600 kilometers an hour. That's pretty fast. Versus the North Pole, where it's going basically zero. It's in place. It's just spinning around. Okay, so we have this very distinctive speed difference. Okay, one of the things that you have to be aware of, and I'll be reiterating this a little bit more in a minute, is that as you can see on here, there's arrows that are curving in two different directions. It's very important to understand that we are these objects are moving to the right in the northern hemisphere in the direction they are going. Think about a street. Driving a car, most of you do that. You could be driving in the street and you're going in one direction. If you're going to turn right, that's this way. You turn to the right. If you're going in the other direction and you turn to the right, you're not going the same direction. You're going the other way. It's a different right turn. So here, if this object is moving in this direction, a right turn is here. But if the object is moving in this direction, this is a right turn. In the southern hemisphere is to the left. Object moving in this direction towards the equator going to the left. Here, objects moving towards the pole are going to the left. So it's always the direction that these particular objects are moving. Now, if we take what we talked about last time, that convection and the Coriolis effect, we combine these together, it gives us a circular flow pattern, not straight north-south. And that circular flow pattern is really important. You've seen this particular picture before. This is showing that convection process where warm air is heating up the equator here, and it's best to look at it on the side because here it's three dimensions and it's really hard to see something coming straight out at you. But here you can see these arrows depicting this warm air rising, moving away from the Earth, being pushed to the north, to the south, that is towards the poles, cooling and sinking, cooling here and sinking. And then being pulled back towards the equator, being pulled back towards the equator. That's these blue lines warming and this whole process. Well, this isn't exactly what is going to happen. Again, our convection is that general circulation pattern that moves air between the equator and the poles. It's that vertical movement of these particular molecules. Now, if you couple that with the Coriolis effect, these molecules that are moving above the Earth here towards the pole are not going from here straight. They're being deflected to the right. In the southern hemisphere, same thing is happening. These molecules that are rising and moving towards the poles are not going straight. They're being deflected to the left. That combination gives this circular airflow pattern. These molecules are coming this way. As they come back towards the equator along the surface, they're moving to the right. So they're going this direction. So we have this circular airflow pattern, which is actually what is happening. It's not a straight north-south pattern. We also have that issue that I mentioned earlier about the fact that we don't have the air molecules actually making it from the equator all the way to the poles. That's not realistic. These air molecules will cool and sink much faster. And because they do that, we have the atmospheric circulation cells. Now, these are really important. Those of you in geology previously, you should be very familiar with these particular circulation cells. There are six of them. You need to know each. You need to know where they are, and you need to know their unique corresponding winds. Okay, these are smaller regions of wind patterns, and you can see them listed here. Here's our equator. There's a region of wind pattern right here, one right here, one right here. There's another one here, here, and here. So three of these in each of the hemispheres. The first one, and this is the most important one because this is where everything starts. It's called the Hadley cell. And if you look at the picture here, here's the Hadley cell. And again, this is three-dimensional. But we only can really see what's happening if we look at it on the edge. So this entire blue circle is happening all the way around the entire globe. The Hadley cell, this is right around the equator. This is where that warm air, the most intense rays of the sun, are shining down here. The air is going to warm and rise. That's what's happening here and here. As it rises, more air is going to rise behind it. Push that air somewhere so the air has to start peeling off because gravity is holding it close. And it's now moving to the north and to the south. All of the moisture now has cooled. It has cooled enough that the moisture is going to fall. So all that moisture precipitates out here. So now we have this drier air moving towards the north and to the south. It's cooling. And by the time it gets to 30 degrees latitude, that's this 0 to 30 degrees. So it goes from 0 at the equator to 30 degrees. By the time it gets to that 30 degrees, it's going to sink back down. When it sinks back down, Some of those air molecules are going to go towards the poles. Some of these air molecules are going towards the poles. And some of them are going to go back down towards the equator. Some of them are going to go back towards the equator. As they travel towards the equator, these are now molecules that are moving along the surface. These particular molecules that are moving along the surface are the trade winds. And these trade winds, again, in the northern hemisphere, they're moving to the right, are all of these blue lines here. I can't draw the lines out here because it's three dimensions. We can't see that. But we can see these lines here that are actually along the surface. That's these guys. They're not straight. They're curved to the right. So you can see that in the direction that these winds are going, they curve to the right. These are the trade winds. They're going to warm up, again, come away from the Earth, cool, sink back down. And so now we have this circular flow pattern. In the southern hemisphere, same thing, except that they're moving to the left. And again, here it is, moving to the left. Along the surface of the Earth, that's these guys here. They're going to warm, move away from the surface, cool, and sink back down again. The next cell is called the Farrell cell. The Farrell cells up here and down here, these particular cells are between 30 degrees and 60 degrees. They do the same thing. The air here has cooled and sank back down from part of the Hadley cells. It now moves towards the pole. It now moves towards the pole. It's going to warm up because it's near the surface of the Earth. That surface of the Earth is the heat source. That's what is being, the sun is shining down on, and it's absorbing 50% of the energy from the sun. So it heats the air molecules here up. But as these air molecules are traveling along the surface, they're moving to the right in the direction that these particular molecules are traveling. Excuse me, to the right here, they're traveling this direction. That's this way, and you can see these particular air molecules curving here. Same thing down here, except it's moving to the left. So these molecules here are going to the left, and you can see these molecules here spinning to the left. Those corresponding winds here going to the right, these are the westerlies. They're named that because they are coming from the west. Very important to remember that all the winds are named from the direction that they are coming from. So here are the westerlies, part of that Farrell cell. The third and final cell, the polar cell, these ones are, wait for it, at the poles, all right? 60 to 90 degrees, so that's up here and down here. So we have the 60 to 90 degree area. The air here in the Farrell cell that has risen at that 60 degree, because it's warmed up, some of that air is going to travel back towards 30, and some of that is going to go towards the pole. When it gets to 90 degrees, that's straight up. Look, here's 0, right here, and here's 90. That's where we get that 90 degrees. Okay, so we have that 90 up at the top. As this air comes and sinks down here, we use the globe. This air is sinking down right here. It only can go towards the equator. It can't go in any other direction. So the air that cools at the polar cell sinks down at the pole, travels towards the equator, sinks down at the pole, travels towards the equator. As it's traveling towards the equator, these air molecules, again, in the northern hemisphere, move to the right in the direction that they're going. So to the right is this way, and these form the polar easterly winds. These are moving from the east towards the west. So it's the direction that these particular winds are moving from. Remember, the movement of these particular molecules, whether it's moving to the right in the northern hemisphere or to the left, has to do with the direction that they're going. If you can make sure that you start here in the middle, at the equator, the air rises, the air moves to the north and to the south, towards the poles. The air then will cool and sink. The air then cools and sinks. You can start there and then just complete those particular cells. So once it cools and sinks, some of the air is going to connect here, some of the air is going to move this way. If it's along the surface of the Earth, it's going to, along the surface of the Earth, it's going to warm and rise. If it's along that surface of the Earth, then you know it has to be warming up. The only time it can be cool is if it's away from the Earth. If it's away from the Earth, it's going to cool and sink back towards. So make sure you understand the movement of the air molecules in each one of these particular cells. That is extraordinarily important. So we've got a couple things here. One, the movement of those air molecules, so know where the air is moving. Understand the winds that belong in and with each of these cells. And obviously know where those particular cells are. Knowing the winds means that you understand the direction that the Coriolis effect is making them bend. And here's another view of that same thing with these particular winds. We've got the air rising here, moving towards the pole, cooling and sinking, moving along the surface. This is three dimensions. We can cut out this air mass here. So we can see the movement as it's coming back from this 30 degrees towards that 0 degrees. It's moving to the right. Here it's moving to the left. That's the important part that you need to be getting out of that particular picture. Now, as the winds are moving along the surface, a lot of blue here. Okay? As these winds move, they're pushing the water, and this is the formation of these surface currents. Okay, there's a couple things that allow these surface currents to form, the causes. One is the wind. And the wind is transferring energy as it blows across the water, friction right there. As the wind blows across the water, we have these westerlies, they're involved in our weather, so they're pushing this water this way. What's going to pile up over here against the continent? The continent asks a big break, so the water piles up here, and then the water is going to slide down that slope. So we have this change in sea level. So we have the wind, we have the change in sea level, and we have density differences. Cooler water is going to be more dense, and so that's going to push down the water, and again, it's going to cause that water to form a particular slope. Okay. If you take a look at this particular map, you can see that there's a few kind of generalized areas. A generalized area right here is the North Atlantic Ocean. It's an ocean basin. There's another one over here that actually extends all the way to the Pacific on this side. So this is one North Pacific Ocean basin. There's a South Pacific basin. There's a South Atlantic basin. And there's an Indian Ocean basin. Within each one of those, we have what scientists call the gyres. There's many others, but these are the five major gyres, and you should know each one of these. Okay, the gyres are formed when the westerlies are pushing water. Now, it's really easy to use the North Atlantic here kind of as our example because it's fairly clearly delineated. So we have these westerlies, these winds blowing in this direction. So they're pushing this water here across the ocean. As this water moves across the ocean, it piles up over here. This water is then going to slide down this slope this way. Well, we have trade winds that are now blowing down here, and they're pushing the water in this direction. So this mass of water sliding this way gets pushed over here, where it piles up along the continent over here, the Americas. And then we have these westerlies as it slides this way, which pushes it off in this particular direction. Okay, you need to know the names of these gyres. Very easy. The North Atlantic Gyre. The South Atlantic Gyre. The Indian Ocean Gyre. And then we have the North and South Pacific Ocean Gyres. Take a look at how these arrows are actually showing these particular oceans moving around. We have, in the Southern Hemisphere, three of these gyres. That comes over here as well. They are all spinning counterclockwise. Here in the North Pacific, there's only two. Or North Pacific and North Atlantic. In the Northern Hemisphere, there's only two. And these two spin clockwise. That is very, very, very important. Now, with each one of these gyres, and this is where people get a little confused, we have four individual currents that create each one of these particular gyres. The first one is called the Western Boundary Current. The Western Boundary Currents always are along the eastern continental coast. Here's our east coast of the United States. The Western Boundary Current in the Atlantic is right here in red. These always carry warm water from the equator towards the pole. Got to have that down. Always carrying warm water from the equator to the pole. So western boundary, W. Warm water, W. Easier to remember. One that you should know is this one here. It's tough to read. This is the Gulf Stream. This is that warm water current that runs from the Gulf of Mexico along our coast and out towards England. On the opposite side of the ocean is the eastern boundary currents. Here they're labeled in blue. These currents are along the western coasts. They are always carrying cool water. So here along our coast, alongside California, we have this particular current right here, the eastern boundary current. These guys always carry cool water towards the equator. Make sure you have that down. The California current. The Peru current. Cool water towards the equator. You notice that they're moving in these opposite directions here. The next two are called the northern transverse and the southern transverse currents. In each gyre, doesn't matter if it's in the northern hemisphere or southern hemisphere, every gyre has a northern transverse current and a southern transverse current. Northern, southern. Northern, southern. It has to do with that particular area, not whether it's in the north or the south. Another place where people get confused. Northern transverse current here. Southern transverse current down here. Southern transverse, northern transverse. These particular currents are the major east-west currents. Northern transverse currents are up here in the northern hemisphere, are powered by the westerlies. In the northern hemisphere, the southern transverse are powered by the trade winds. In the southern hemisphere, the northern transverse currents are powered by the trade winds, these winds that are blowing this direction. And the southern transverse currents are powered by the westerlies. So make sure that you know that the transverse currents are powered by both the trade winds and these particular westerlies. These are the two currents that provide the energy for moving this water around. So we have our western boundary, we have our eastern boundary, and we have our northern transverse, southern transverse. We must know this information. Those are our major surface currents.